Hi, I'm Carl Colby. I'm the director of The Man Nobody Knew, a film about my father, William Colby, who was a CIA spy master. And the film will open in Washington, D.C. October 28th. It opens in Los Angeles October 14th, Chicago October 21st, and continues to play in New York, and it's going to go nationwide. I made this film because I thought that this story should be told. This is a story of a man who took on the toughest, dirtiest assignments really ever given out by a president. And this man, my dad, did these jobs until he could do more and more. And he did what the president wanted until in the 70s, when he was director of the CIA, he revealed the family jewels, the CIA secrets, really, for the last 25, 30 years, all the way back to the Eisenhower administration. And the White House wanted him to stop. Don't talk to Congress. Well, he felt the ultimate authority was the Congress. The people have a right to know. And so he told the secrets. He might have kept a few secrets back, but he told a lot of secrets. And for that, he was sort of eaten up, chewed up, spit out, and thrown away. And I think it's a cautionary tale. It's a morality tale also. My mother keeps my father to a very high moral standard, and they kind of compete for the high moral ground, but ultimately, he's a soldier, and he's sacrificing, and we're sacrificing for him to do his job. And there are thousands of women and men now lifting off from bases all around the world to preserve our freedoms, and I'm just afraid that if things ever got too bad, then the agency would be blamed again for the misdiscretions of the agency would be blamed for the transgressions of the president. Because after all, it's really not the CIA that you think is ordering all this, it's the president. In Vietnam, my father was there early on. The whole family, we all lived in Saigon before Diem and Nu were murdered in a coup attempt that was hatched by JFK, RFK, and Ambassador Lodge. And my dad had a hand in it, even though he disagreed with it. But my father was early in Vietnam working on counterinsurgency. And then the big war started, Johnson's War. Big mass troops, Americans firing into the jungle, and the country that I knew as a boy was being destroyed. And my father went back and ran the Cords pacification program, of which Phoenix was an element. And his war was a political war. He was at the grassroots level. He wasn't firing from the sky. He was interrogating, investigating, and possibly turning captured VC to work for the South Vietnamese. And it was a brutal program, and there were abuses, but he was fighting the war the best he knew how. And he was called Heinrich Himmler. He was called a murderer. People would say to me, your dad's a war criminal. And it was tough to take, because we had to take what he was doing on faith and trust as being the right thing. And I always thought he was up to no good, but the no good was for a good cause. It's a strange world. You're asking very talented men and women to ask other people to betray their country. You're asking them to do very illegal things in other countries where they could be picked up, arrested, prosecuted, held in jail. And they never get any accolades. There are no parades for CIA officers or special operations personnel. Italy was wonderful. It was the world of sort of the coming along of really was wonderful. It was like La Dolce Vita every day of the week. And I still go back to Italy and I feel like I'm a 10-year-old boy. I'm completely comfortable. Everything's well with the world. And it was actually a titanic struggle between the Christian Democrats and the Communist Party at the time. But my father funded the Christian Democrats and taught them ways of sort of defeating the Communists at the polls and probably a lot of other covert actions. And we succeeded, so everything was kind of rosy. And then Vietnam, the story turns darker. I never really had the courage to ask my father, do you love me? Or worse, who's more important? You and your job, or me and the family? I didn't go there, because I suspected I would get, you know, the first answer, which is my job's more important. But, you know, it really didn't faze me. I believed in what he was doing. I thought he was tasked with something special. and it was my job to help his job. And it was, my relationship with my mother was always terrific, really. She very inspirational. She's my biggest fan. I remember making a film a long time ago, and I had a screening, and there was an invitation to the screening, and I'd go back years later, and the same invitation is still, you know, with a magnet on the refrigerator. So I remember thinking, you know, I've got one fan, but you know, in life, all you really need is one fan. And she's been that fan, and this process of making the film was extraordinary with me, because I was able to sort of get closer to my mother, understand her, understand really how tough and steely she is at her core, and how she was bitterly disappointed by my father in the end, but she has great resilience, great strength. I started making a film about my father as the American character, and in a lot of ways, at the end of the film, my mother is the great American character. It was devastating. I mean, we had taken all of what my father had done on faith and trust, and suddenly he lets it all go. He divorces. He lies, really, about him. We were devastated. I was devastated. I thought, what does it all mean? I mean, we were all supportive of him. We sacrificed for him. And what did it mean? Who would do this? And maybe we're just the cover. We were a family. We traveled all around. It all looks fabulous from the photographs, but maybe behind the scenes it was kind of a cardboard cutout. Maybe he always was the gray man and we were the cover. I think my father worked on his boat all day, and he was probably pretty exhausted, had a few drinks, took a canoe ride, I'm not really sure why, and probably had a stroke or a heart attack or some upset, fell out of the boat, found himself in the water, and in the end, you know, I think he was done. I remember telling him some months before that, I called him up and I said, oh, I heard your old friend, Judge whatever, from Vermont. He lives in Middlebury. He was found under a bridge in Middlebury, Vermont, all night long, sleeping under a bridge. He's got advanced Alzheimer's. It's terrible. And my father said, oh, that'll never happen to me. I said, yeah? He said, yep. He said, one day you're going to hear that I was walking on a goat path on a Greek island, and I fell into the sea. I said, that's it? Yep, that's it.